Hello, I'm V.B. Price. I'm the editor of NewMexicoMercury.com. We're here today in the Mercury Library with old friend Don Hancock, who is the Nuclear Waste Safety Program expert and director at the Southwest Research and Information Center in Albuquerque. Don, in my estimation, is the guy who knows as much as anybody in the state and in the nation about WIPP, the Waste Isolation Pilot Project in Carlsbad, and is a most reliable source because Don always says exactly what he thinks, and he never tries to fudge it, and he never goes overboard, in my judgment, nor does he underplay it either. So it's an honor to have you here with us today. I've got a lot of questions. I know our viewers, you have a lot of questions too about this really almost preposterous situation now, this really colossal failure and all kinds of imagery of kitty litter and organic kitty litter and other kinds of strange things. So if I could ask you about how, about the overall history of what's happened since Valentine's Day this year. And then if we could sort of get into the significance of those events, and then we'll ask some other things about specifics. Anyway, it's great to have you here.
Thanks for your continuing interest in the important story. I appreciate it. So Valentine's Day, something happened that was never supposed to happen, which is a radiation release from the underground to above ground. We subsequently now know, DOE has admitted that 22 workers were contaminated from this release or continuing releases. Obviously, more workers are at risk as they go underground to try to figure out what happened. So this is a serious problem. There is contamination not just inside of 22 people, but obviously into the environment. And how much that is, we probably will never know because radionuclides are in the air, then they fall into the soil. You can't survey every single place to figure out. There's a lot of soil samples that have been taken, for example, by the New Mexico Environment Department that have not yet been analyzed in any laboratory. So I mean, there's still a lot of things like that that we don't know. Even more importantly, we don't really know what happened in the underground. We know that there was radioactivity, that some significant amount of radioactivity that came out, and some of it traveled more than a mile and a half, and we don't know how far it all traveled, and we don't know how much it was, so there's still lots that we don't know about that, but we don't really know what's happened. There have been workers now that have been into the underground to room 7 of panel 7, where the highest levels of radioactivity are and where they think the problem happened. They haven't been able to physically get to the one or more containers that, to use the word that DOE doesn't like to use, exploded or had some kind of a deflagration. They have pictures of one container that's clearly breached, has holes, the lid is off, there are signs, there's melting around and signs of thermal, small amounts of fire, etc. There are a variety of containers that you can see physically, and then pictures of that, the magnesium oxide, the backfill that's on top of them is scattered around, etc. So clearly something major happened, but we still don't know what happened. We still don't know how many containers are involved. I think it's very likely it's more than the one that they've so far seen. DOE agrees that they need to keep looking to see if there are more breached containers. The reason I think there's probably more than one is while this particular container has 16 or 17 curies of plutonium and americium in it, which is a much larger amount than maybe what the average container is, there are containers, including one sitting right beside it, that have more radioactivity and that, you know, but the point of all that is we don't know how much came out, but from what we do know of what came out, it looks to me like it was more than what could have come out of a single container.
This is fascinating. I've been so eager to ask you these questions. Why haven't they been able to get a human being in there?
One is, in this room, there are 258 containers of contact-handled waste stacked. There aren't any, they're stacked wall to wall.
No aisles.
So there are no aisles. There never are aisles. They're not required to be aisles. So you can't, it's not like you're in a warehouse and you can walk down the row to see what's happening. So physically, they can't, they would have to move containers to get to the containers they see, the containers they walk up to look fine. They look the way they did before February 14th. But it's containers behind, and you can't physically get to the containers behind without moving the containers in front, and there are good reasons to not necessarily move the containers in front, which is why it's taken them longer, because they've, in addition to the workers, they've had to bring in cameras, they've had to put cameras on booms, you know, so they can put them over the tops of the containers to try to look and see what they can. And again, 258 containers, fairly tightly packed, it's hard to get a camera into. Another point that hasn't been talked about, the container that they've seen identified in the pictures as breached is a 55-gallon drum. 55-gallon drums at WIPP are in 7-packs. You have 6 containers and one in the middle. If you have, you physically can't get to the container that's in the middle because it's surrounded by. So if you had a middle container of a 7-pack that is breached, a camera won't even, you can't even see it by a camera. So that's why I say it will be very difficult to identify all of the containers that are breached. And therefore, it's also going to be difficult to figure out what actually happened, what caused the breaches to happen.
So I suppose they don't have any aisles or anything like that, because they never thought that they would even have to do any of this. And this was supposed to be 10,000 years. We all know those stories. What do you think is one of the ultimate significant meanings of this? When you really have the nation's, I believe, only underground nuclear repository, waste repository, suddenly going terribly wrong like this. What does this mean?
Well, it means lots of things. And, you know, to just hit on a few of them, it means that something that was never supposed to happen happened. Something bad, very bad, that was never supposed to happen happened. So that shows we don't know as much about handling waste, about geologic repositories, as we've been told, and in fact, government and corporate people thought they knew. We're almost 4 months since Valentine's Day, and they still, as we've discussed, they still don't know what happened and why it happened. So we don't know as much as we think we know, is one lesson. Another lesson is that regardless of how good or not we thought the facility was performing for 15 years, it wasn't actually performing. The internal DOE investigations that have happened so far and been published have indicated a variety of problems with the facility other than just the fire and the radiation release. So again, it wasn't operated as safely as people thought, so that's another issue. The regulation clearly wasn't adequate, because the regulation should have helped to prevent these kinds of things from happening. In a broader context, it raises significant issues for the nation and the world about what to do with nuclear waste. Because the waste that we're talking about, while it's dangerous, is not the most dangerous nuclear waste that we have, either from nuclear weapons or nuclear power plants. And waste isolation pilot plant, the concept, one of the concepts of WIPP is it would demonstrate the safe disposal, to use the language of the 1979 law. It would demonstrate safe disposal, so then we could build off of that and learn from that and do other things. Well, now what we have to learn is we don't know as much as we thought. And if it's going to be a pilot plant, it's going to be a pilot plant to see if we can, for the first time in history, decontaminate a radiologically contaminated salt mine. So that's never been done, so that would be pilot. Or if the other sort of major alternative is to say, well, we probably can't clean it up, shouldn't clean it up, let's declare it good enough, and how do we close it up in a way that it's not likely to have further leaks long-term into the future. So any scenario shows that we have a whole lot that we need to know that we don't know, and it should be a lesson in we don't know as much as we think we know, and we don't really know as much as we should know in order to move forward with basically irretrievable kinds of things like putting waste without aisles in a facility that we know over time is going to collapse. So those are lessons that we need to learn, and it will be important to learn those lessons. It's also important to follow what happens. I mean, DOE wants to say these 22 workers haven't had any health impacts. We don't know whether that's true or not, because as far as we know, none of these workers have had independent medical assessment from people who know how to treat internal radiation contamination, which is a small group of medical folks, because fortunately we don't have lots of people around who have contamination. I think it should be important not that these 22 workers are guinea pigs, but they need to be followed in terms of what happens to them over time, because again, it's a small subset of folks here, but they're real human beings. We should take care of them. We should find out, follow what happens to them over time. The danger of plutonium and americium is internal contamination that causes cancers. Cancers don't develop and have their symptoms develop in, 30 seconds normally. They develop over time. So while DOE thinks that the amount of contamination that these workers got shouldn't cause a health effect, we have 22 workers that unfortunately we should be able to learn some things from, but from a health standpoint, they should be getting independent medical treatment of not DOE doctors, but people who understand this stuff, so that we can learn some things on that human, very human health kind of scale as well.
So here we are in a situation in which we really don't know much, probably can't know much for quite a while. And yet we have stories surfacing in the newspapers which seem to lead people to believe that we do know what happened. And some of them are even, I would call them ludicrous, fairly silly. Or worse, kitty litter, for instance, organic kitty litter versus non-organic kitty litter, to absorb liquid, apparently, in drums that aren't supposed to have any liquid at all. So I know that what you've just said has basically contradicted the whole notion of knowing what's happened. But so could you discuss the kitty litter issue, and could you also discuss the other possible scenarios that you've heard or that are possible that you've thought of?
For more than 25 years, there have been containers of transuranic waste, the kind that go into WIPP, that have had leaks and explosions, not at WIPP, but at other places where they've been. So the idea that you can have things blowing up, exploding, releases, it has happened. It has happened at several places. It has happened in Idaho. It's happened in Oak Ridge, Tennessee. It's happened at Savannah Riverside. It's happened at Hanford, Washington. Because of that, the Environmental Evaluation Group, that was the independent WIPP monitoring group that was formed in the late 70s and worked until 2004, did a couple of reports in the 80s and then one in 1991 that went into some detail about this history of exploding, leaking containers. So it is not It is not an unknown phenomenon, which is why some restrictions were put on as a result of that history of knowing bad things can happen. That's the reason some restrictions were both by DOE and by the regulations put into effect to try to prevent this kind of thing from happening. So nitrate salts are used in the plutonium operations at Los Alamos. They've been used at Hanford. They've been used at Idaho. So we've known there are nitrate salts in a lot of the containers. That's something that's actually traced and recorded. Well, it's used as part of the processing to mitigate the handling of the plutonium materials. And so then the nitrates are contaminated, but they also help in the processing, maintaining stability in the process. And it's therefore known nitrate salts and nitric acid can have an explosive kind of situation. So you need to do something about that. So to get rid of, as you said, to get rid of the liquids, to absorb the liquids. So when your cat is leaking, we call it kitty litter, but in a broader chemical industrial sense, there are a variety of absorbents that you can use to clean up liquids, right? So, you know, it's kind of offensive to cat lovers of the world to blame things on cats. And it's not like you're going out and buying commercial kitty litter, etc. So can there be inorganic and organic absorbents that are used with the nitric acids and the nitrate salts? The answer is yes. That's happened for a long time. We've known that. Those are not typically exploding drums, however. So that doesn't really explain what happened. There are numerous drums that look very much like, and as far as we can tell, were handled exactly the same as the one container that shows is being breached on the pictures. The others haven't. The particular drum that they show being breached was sealed up more than 5 months before February 14th. So why did it take it so long for something to happen? There are other containers that are very similar that have been sitting either at Los Alamos or now at Waste Control Specialist in Texas or at WIPP for longer than 5 months that seem not to have exploded. So, as I say, we don't know what happened. But to your question, what else could have happened? Just like liquids are supposed to be absorbed so you don't have liquid sloshing around at WIPP, you're also other combustibles, flammable explosives are by permit prohibited from WIPP. But that doesn't mean there aren't. The reason for the prohibition is some of these materials have historically been in containers. So even though they're prohibited, could something prohibited have come to WIPP in one or more of these containers? Yes, that's a different possibility. You also have the possibility is one of the things that can cause explosions is a buildup of hydrogen gas. That's why every single container that comes to WIPP has to have one or more filter vents in it. Vents so that you don't have a buildup of gas, but filters so that you don't just exhaust everything out. So is there a possibility? I don't think there's a possibility that these containers didn't actually have filters because they are multiple check and the records show that they do have filters. Could a filter somehow get clogged in such a way that you had a buildup inside such that over time you burst? That's clearly another possibility. So the kitty litter absorbents, organics contributing to organic kitty litter is not explosive in its own right. Cat lovers don't get worried about that. But you can get chemical reactions if you put things together in wrong way. So I'm not suggesting it's not impossible, but that's not the only suggestion. Also, the other thing I just need to say so that people understand, the first person who popularized the organic kitty litter notion is a guy named James Conca. who for several years was the director of the Carlsbad Environmental Monitoring and Research Center in Carlsbad. He is no longer in that position, but he has long promoted, and I've been on panels with him where he's done it, promoted WIPP as the site for all of the nation's nuclear waste, not just defense waste, not just transuranic waste. He thinks it's a wonderful site and could handle all kinds of much more dangerous waste, which he and I strongly disagree about that point. But he would like the solution to what happened to be something that, for example, Los Alamos did wrong, as opposed to something wrong with WIPP. Because if there's fundamentally something wrong with WIPP, that goes against the idea he's been promoting for years, literally, that and is still promoting. Even after the fire and the explosion, he's still promoting WIPP would be fine place to bring all of the nation's nuclear waste, which just doesn't make any sense. So that doesn't mean he's wrong, but he has an agenda out there that people need to be careful about.
The stories that we've all been reading say, in essence, and it really reads like this, that these guys had bags of kitty litter and that they chose a different kind of kitty litter. And there was a big, big piece in Santa Fe, New Mexico about all kinds of matters like this. But that's not at all what actually happened. This is a story, not an analytical, empirical reality.
Yes, and we don't know what happened. And I think the public and DOE, for that matter, need to focus on more fundamental questions. So, for example, I was in early June, I was at the Department of Energy headquarters in Washington, D.C., talking to the top folks who are in environmental management that are supposed to deal with WIPP and all these other sites. And my first question to the head guy was, and what are your cleanup standards for WIPP? And his response was, well, as you know, we don't have any. And my response to that is, yeah, we should. It shouldn't be hard. The cleanup standard should be to get it back to the situation it was before February 5th. No contamination in the underground. And if people are going to go in the underground, they have to be able to go in a way that they are not exposed to any radioactivity. So, but we should be talking about that.
Yeah.
We should be talking about how the people who want to reopen WIPP should be talking about, and at what price? Price to worker health and safety, price to the taxpayers, because it could be pretty close to a blank check to try to clean it up to get it open. And also related to that is, and should we reward the people who didn't adequately operate this facility, Nuclear Waste Partnership, which is the contractor that gets over $100 million a year to operate the facility safely, and the contract requires them to operate it safely. So do we want to turn around and give these people an unlimited amount of additional money to do when they haven't been able to do it? So do we even have the right people to do the task that we need? One of the things I pointed out in Washington that raise some people's eyes. So the fire at WIPP was on February 5th.
Right.
On February 10th, 5 days later, the Department of Energy awarded a bonus to Nuclear Waste Partners of $1.9 million for a job well done.
Oh, dear.
5 days, this was before the radiation release, but it was 5 days after the fire, and they're being rewarded for doing a good job and getting 93% of the award fee that they could have gotten. Well, that raises questions about how well the contractor's doing, but it also raises questions about the DOE oversight, and are these really the right people to do it? I and many other people are saying what we need is a real independent investigation of a variety of technical people with backgrounds. As I say, we have an unprecedented situation, so it's not like any one or two people know how to fix the problem, because that's not the case, but let's bring together a variety of expert people from New Mexico and around the country with various kinds of expertise to look at the situation, to analyze it, to give us, to look at what DOE is saying, but to give us an independent analysis of what's happened, what the options for decontamination or not are, what the options for dealing with the worker health and safety questions, which I continue to say are very important and should be very important in addition to potential exposures to the public. So rather than getting ahead of ourselves and saying we know what happened and we know what we're going to do and we know how much it's going to cost to fix it and we know we need to get WIPP back in operation in a year or 2 years or 3 years or pick your time frame, that's not what we should be doing. Again, we should be learning some lessons. We didn't know as much as we thought we knew. We still don't know as much as we think we know. We have a lot more to learn, and some of what we have to learn about WIPP and the situation at WIPP is literally unprecedented, not only in the United States, but the world. So we need to go carefully and slowly and figure out what to do and what the best thing to do for the site is, what the best thing to do for the other transuranic waste that still exists at other places like Los Alamos and Hanford and Idaho and Savannah River and Oak Ridge, what to do about what's there. We now have a further problem. Some of the Los Alamos waste has been taken to a new site, Waste Control Specialist in Texas. It was only supposed to be there temporarily. Well, it's had to be repackaged and contained because the potential that something could blow up there. So by being in a hurry to say we know what we're doing and we'll alleviate the problem. So to alleviate the problem at Los Alamos, some waste was sent to Waste Control Specialist. So we now have yet another site that is at risk and what to do about that. So I think we need to, I don't criticize the Department of Energy for going slowly. I think they should go slowly. I think in some cases they should go even more slowly and more carefully than they have been. They certainly need to release more information. They haven't released all the pictures, all the radiation data that they've been getting from going into underground, all the results of the sampling, et cetera. So there's a lot more that they need to do, and we need to have an independent investigation to look at what they're doing and see what else needs to be done. But this is a very difficult and unprecedented problem.
So just to sort of get everybody up to speed, this containment area is a half a mile, 2,100 feet underground, more or less. It's got 170,000 plus of these canisters. It has a vent that goes up a half a mile up into terra firma. This explosion, or whatever it was, had enough power into it to push it down a corridor. It's about 3,000 feet. And then up another two, and then out a mile. So that's quite an oomph. So when you, let's just say that WIPP has to be decommissioned. You obviously take out the smokestack, right? What do you do to it? And how do you assure yourself that others of these canisters aren't going to explode? And what would happen if they did?
Even if WIPP worked perfectly, if it had have worked perfectly, which it didn't, it would eventually have to be closed up. So there's always been the idea we're going to need to fill in those shafts, that not only the exhaust shaft, but the other three shafts where the air comes in, the salt handling shaft and the waste hoist shaft. So there are four that we're going to have to be. So that still would have to be done. And again, there is, because of the contamination, there is some danger. Well, we always knew it was going to have to be decommissioned. The fact that it's as contaminated as it is was not ever really conceived of. So the decommissioning will be harder than what has been proposed or thought about. That doesn't mean it's got to be done sooner or later. So that's going to be more difficult regardless. DOE is to my knowledge, hasn't publicly, but privately are saying one of the things they would do to get it back into operation is to go ahead and seal up that exhaust shaft because it's so contaminated that it's probably not worthwhile doing. And then to get back into operation, they would either need to retrofit one of the other three shafts so it could be the exhaust shaft, or more likely they would want to drill a new shaft. So decommissioning will be a very hard, difficult process, whether it's now or later, but fixing the problem, the many parts of the problem in the underground and on the surface, is going to be a very difficult situation as well. That's why, as I say, we need to look at more broadly. We need to look at those various options and what happens if. So, for example, we were told that the waste was safer in the underground at WIPP than it would be leaving it at the places that it was. Well, in the last 15 years that WIPP's been open, we have no record of these exploding containers that happened longer ago at these sites. So what happened at WIPP during the 15 years is a worse accident than happened at the sites that are storing the transuranic waste. That doesn't necessarily mean that would always be the case, but it goes back to a fundamental point that even the Department of Energy has agreed to in its environmental impact statements related to WIPP. For some period of time, the waste actually is safer leaving it where it is as opposed to transporting it, which has some risks, and putting it in the ground at WIPP, which has some risks. So we need to go rethink, I think, and reanalyze. Okay, WIPP has 91,000 cubic meters of waste and more than 171,000 containers in the underground. So it has more transuranic waste than any place else in the country. So we could seal it up, and that would be the case. We still need to figure out what to do about, you know, the waste that at these other places. But ultimately, if we're going to use geologic repositories, we have to have more than WIPP anyway. So can that waste be safely handled at a 900 square mile site, which is the Idaho National Laboratory? Can it be safely handled at the more than 500 square mile Hanford Reservation in Washington? Can it be safely handled at the more than 300 square mile Savannah River site in South Carolina? Well, the answer has to be yes, because if not, all of those much bigger facilities that have more and more dangerous waste than just the transuranic waste that we're talking about are huge problems, which they are, but, you know, those are problems that we have to deal with anyway. So I think it's very much the case that we need to look at, okay, we have WIPP as it is, what do we do about it? What do we do about the waste at the sites? What do we do, importantly, about the waste that's now at Waste Control Specialist, a non-DOE site in Texas? That probably shouldn't be staying there very long term either. So we have a whole variety of questions that need to be looked at carefully. The public needs to be involved in. Independent regulators, state and federal, need to be looking at it to help us understand what's going on and what the real options to do it, because ultimately releases, whether there are more releases at WIPP or not, are dangerous to the public, but they're also going to affect us because we're going to have to pay for it. And whatever happens at WIPP, it's going to cost us more than it was supposed to cost us.
So, hypothetical question. I'm sure there are proponents of constructing more WIPPs. Is there physically enough room to do that around Carlsbad? Is it pie in the sky, or could such a colossal mistake, to use that word again, actually come about?
So as the proponents of using WIPP or areas near WIPP will say, the salt, like is at the WIPP site, goes for miles and miles and miles. So could more waste be put in such a situation? The answer is yes. Is it a good idea? The answer is no. because the WIPP site itself is surrounded by oil and gas wells. There are potash mines in the area. There is fracking going on near the WIPP site, etc. So unless one thinks it's a good idea to use oil and gas wells to dispose of nuclear waste, which I don't really know anybody that thinks that's a good idea, there are very real limitations. And it's always been one of the concerns that I've had about the facility. It wasn't likely and it shouldn't have happened that it leaked in 15 years, but the likelihood that it's going to leak while the radionuclides are still dangerous over thousands of generations is very high because of the nature of what's around it, etc. So that's not a good thing. But what we should have learned, among the things we should have learned, is salt has problems that weren't fully acknowledged before, and that putting more waste in southeastern New Mexico, where we have a leak that hasn't been cleaned up and we still don't even know what really happened, is not a good idea. As a practical matter, most waste is and should stay basically where it is or very close to where it is for some period of time until we can better figure out how to do geologic repositories, because that does still, is among the four generic options of what to do with waste, two, in my mind, should be totally off the table. Shooting it into the air, outer space, should be off the table. Putting it in the ocean should be off the table. So that really only leaves you two options, leaving it on or near the surface or putting it deep underground. So of those four options, putting it deep underground still makes a lot of sense. But as we've seen with WIPP, putting it underground and then having a leak creates a more serious problem than if it had been on the surface. None of the containers that have leaked over the last 25 years at other places have created nearly the kind of contamination and damage that has happened at WIPP. So if you just look at the reality as what has happened, putting it underground was the worst situation, which doesn't mean that it's okay to have exploding drums at LANL when there are workers around. That's not at all what I'm suggesting. It can be more safely contained and monitored and handled if it's in a facility above ground where there is aisle spacing, where you can put cement around it as they're doing a waste control specialist, or fire protection curtains around it, or put it in bigger containers. I mean, those things can be done when it's on the surface at various places. Those things can't be done when you have releases in the underground at WIPP. So we need to rethink some of sort of the classic thinking that we've been using in the last several decades.
So I've always been worried about these workers and always have been very irritated, once again, with claims that this is not dangerous and don't worry about it. Everybody's nice kids. I mean, I worry about their families who may have come into contact with this through sputum or other things, or coughing. And I worry, frankly, a little bit about Carlsbad, because I don't really know or haven't heard anything about what the extent of the movement of this stuff over the town was. Could you sort of talk a little bit about that and get us up to speed?
So all of the 13 workers, including security guards, who were at the site around the time that the major release appears to have happened. And I see major release because it wasn't just a one-time 30-second event. It went on for longer than that, clearly. We don't, again, know how long it went on. But all 13 workers that were there at the time were contaminated. And then another 130 internally contaminated. They breathed in some of the radioactivity. They were on the surface. They weren't in the underground. They were on the surface, but they weren't all around the exhaust shaft either, the place where it was coming out. I mean, the security guards were hundreds of yards away, but still got contaminated, which shows, again, sort of some of the extent of what happened. So that was bad enough. But then Saturday morning, February 15th, another 135 workers came in to work who should have never been allowed to come in the first place. And DOE has now said that the testing that they've done, the urine and fecal testing they've done of them, showed that an additional 9 workers also breathed in and had contamination, which again shows that it didn't all just happen in a few minutes, because people who were showing up 6 or 7 or 8 hours later also got contaminated. So the concern that I've had is obviously they shouldn't have been contaminated in the first place, but they should have been examined very quickly by medical people, trained medical people. They weren't. The first ones weren't even asked. Apparently, from what we know, and again, the information isn't totally clear, but apparently the first worker who was tested asked to be tested because he or she, I think it was a he, was concerned that he might have been contaminated. But DOE was saying, oh, you don't need to be tested. And at least one, according to what we've seen from the accident investigation report, at least one other worker asked to be tested before the workers were asked to be tested. So clearly the workers have some concerns about that. But DOE's official position is there's no need for any more testing on these workers. They don't need to have more urine or fecal analysis done or whole body counts because their dose was less than 10 millirem. So from a DOE standpoint, there's no harm, no foul. I don't agree with that. I think the workers should be able to get independent treatment. I think they should be able to get second opinions paid for by the health insurance, not having to be paid for by the workers themselves. They may need to go to other places because there aren't medical doctors in Carlsbad that are trained to deal with internal contamination because they haven't had to deal with it historically. And again, of course, they were never expected to have to deal with it. So I'm concerned about that. In terms of the general public, I've gotten phone calls from people in Carlsbad and a lot farther away than that saying, you know, am I going to get contaminated by this WIPP release? And what I tell people is, as far as we know, the answer is no. That doesn't mean there wasn't release, and it doesn't mean there isn't some amount off-site, but the testing that's been done so far shows low levels, shows measurable levels in some cases of contamination from WIPP that's beyond what just the 22 workers got. And the fact that some of it's in the soil and people walk across, the winds come and blow it away means, you know, we'll never be able to recapture everything that was lost, nor will we ever be able to totally, completely calculate what did get out. Although as we find out, insofar as we can find out how many drums were actually affected in the underground, there can be some calculations of how much could have come out. So my point is not that what I've said to people is you are correct to be concerned. You are correct to continue to want more information and to insist on continuing monitoring, and not just by the Department of Energy, but by independent agencies, the Carlsbad Environmental Monitoring Center on the one hand, the New Mexico Environment Department on the other hand, that those people should release all of their results, not conclusions, but all the actual data that they get in terms of what the levels are and where they are, etc., so that people can, for themselves and talking to other people, can judge for themselves about whether they're at risk. The unfortunate reality that we all live with, however, every place, and especially in New Mexico, but every place, almost every place on Earth, is because of nuclear bomb explosions and testing that have been done by several countries, including the United States, there is a lot of plutonium and americium in the environment from nuclear weapons. The WIPP release, in comparison to that, is very much smaller. Okay, so doesn't mean that weapons testing didn't have health effects, because it does. Doesn't mean that the WIPP release could not have health effects, because it could. But insofar as so far the data show it's much less. But again, we have this waste that exists in the underground at WIPP. Could there be more leaks? The answer is yes. We have some of this waste at place like Los Alamos and Waste Control Specialist and Hanford and Oak Ridge and Idaho and Savannah River. Should people be concerned about it? Yes. Should they insist that it be safely packaged and monitored and handled at those facilities? Answer is yes. Does that mean in some cases it needs better protection than what currently exists? Yes. So those kinds of things should happen. So people should continue to be concerned about it. But do I tell people, no, you shouldn't go to Carlsbad, or no, you can't live in Artesia because you're upwind or you're in Albuquerque and you should be concerned? Unfortunately, we have lots of risks to health, public health and safety that are out there that, for the time being, as far as we know, are even greater than the ones posed by this particular release or releases from WIPP.
So we know that the new Secretary of the Environment, Ryan Flynn, who's an attorney and sort of notorious for what's known as the Copper Rule, has come out maybe 2 weeks ago or a week and a half ago with a finding of imminent endangerment to public health at WIPP. Now, I think this caught a lot of us off guard, but apparently this is a sort of normal procedural move that would allow them to do other things if necessary.
So under the federal law, which is called the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, and under the state law related to that, which is called the Hazardous Waste Act, there are procedures that the regulator, the Environment Department, and the permittees, the regulated entity, the Department of Energy and Nuclear Waste Partnership, the contractor, have to do normally. And there are permits that say you can do this and you can't do that and that sort of thing. The law, that those laws allow, in case of a finding of imminent and substantial endangerment, allows the Environment Department to require the permittees to take actions that normally they wouldn't be allowed to require. So from a legal standpoint, and this is not the first time this has happened, previous environment secretaries issued similar orders for Los Alamos and Sandia to get them to do activities that Los Alamos and Sandia didn't want to do. So it's allowed the secretaries of the Environment Department, not just Secretary Flynn, but as I say, previous secretaries have done this kind of thing. Secretary Curry, for example, did this. So on the one hand, it's a procedural thing. In order, Secretary Flynn is rightly concerned about the situation at Los Alamos and at WIPP. So in order for him to exercise more authority than he would normally be allowed to do, he needed to make this finding. That's different than saying that people are going to die imminently because of something that he knows is going to happen. Okay. In the case of Los Alamos and Sandia back 10 years ago, they resisted this finding. They said, no, it's not imminent substantial. We shouldn't have to do this. And so there were court battles and other kinds of things. To their credit, the Department of Energy, he issued this finding not only about WIPP, but also about some of the containers at Los Alamos. So he's required Los Alamos to do some things that otherwise he wouldn't be able to do under the Los Alamos permit. He wants WIPP to do some things that otherwise he wouldn't be. To their credit, so far, well, Congressman Pierce from southeastern New Mexico's initial reaction was Secretary Flynn exceeded his authority to even do this. To their credit, the Department of Energy at WIPP and at Los Alamos have not said that. So I hope that they will follow through. So there's a bureaucratic legal issue about the imminent and substantial thing that the secretary, in my mind, rightly pursued. So now the question is, what he wants to have happen, which again I agree with, is how do we try to make sure that something similar doesn't happen to containers that are at Los Alamos? And how do we, on the one hand, and on the other hand, at WIPP, what do we do about the fact that there are similar containers to the one that's been identified to being breached? They're in both panel 7 and in panel 6. And he's saying maybe we need to do some things to, if we can't keep another event from happening because of some of the kind of things we've talked about, can we at least create better barriers so if something happens, it won't leak out as it did the last time? And again, those are, so what he's required, what Secretary Flynn's required, is for LANL on the one hand and WIPP on the other hand to come up with plans for how they deal with this problem. LANL has come up with the plan, has actually implemented the things they're going to say. The Environment Department hasn't finally said yet whether the plan is okay or not, but, you know, LANL is making fast progress because they have an easier problem, so to speak, as we've talked about. On May 30th, DOE did present their plan to the Environment Department to what to do about closing up Panel 6 and Room 7 of Panel 7. And in short, without boring people with going through the numerous pages, there are, in my view, there are some serious inadequacies with the plan, which I intend to discuss with the Environment Department. And I would hope other people will discuss with the Environment Department as well. But the bottom line from DOE's standpoints, it would be months at least before they could seal up either of those two things. And panel 6 is the easier one. Panel 7, that has a lot more contamination, is obviously the harder one. They don't even put a exact timeline that they think. They gave time frames to do specific things, which could total over a year in some cases. Again, we're back to, this is a very difficult problem. I applaud the Environment Department for trying to take aggressive action to get DOE to say to the public and to the Environment Department what they can and can't do. But as I've said to the Environment Department before, just because DOE says this is what they can and can't do, one shouldn't just accept that. So that, again, the idea of bringing in outside experts to kind of say what can and can't be done is good. And we also need to keep in mind whether what we're doing is to contain a further release or is what we're doing to try to say WIPP is okay and let's get it back into operation. I think the second shouldn't be what any kind of goal is now. And if what it takes to try to keep something bad from happening in the short run makes it more difficult to reopen the facility, that should be okay too. Again, we need, but again, the public needs to be involved in talking about what our goals and criteria are, even if we don't know all the technical details of what can and can't be done. So again, people need to pay attention. I encourage people to be talking to the Environment Department about what's going on and their concerns, and encourage the Environment Department to do what they have been doing, which is putting information on their website, the NMED WIPP incident website, that DOE refuses to put on its website. That's, DOE is still behaving badly. They're still not putting out the information they should. I appreciate, and they've criticized the Environment Department for putting out some of the DOE information. As the regulator, DOE has to give the Environment Department information. The Environment Department thinks, as they correctly are thinking and should do, they should therefore make that information public. DOE doesn't like the fact that the Environment Department makes this some information public. So the Environment Department should continue to make all information public. It should insist that the public be involved in looking at what's going on, and they should listen to the public, because these are very difficult issues. I want to insist again that it's not like there are easy answers to these questions. They're very complicated. We need the best minds, the best people involved as much as possible, and we need to be careful, because we could make a bad situation worse. We could make a bad situation worse by saying nothing more bad is going to happen. Mm-hmm. That would be a mistake. But we can also make a mistake, as was done, by shipping Los Alamos Waste to Waste Control Specialist. You know, we now have yet another site that is at risk. We don't want to put workers going into the underground to do these various things at further risk, that unnecessary risk, etc. So these things are going to take time. They are going to be difficult. We need to make sure the workers who have concerns about whether they're being put into danger have outlets to say that without getting fired or otherwise in trouble, as happened at other DOE sites. When people raise health and safety concerns, well, they get fired, they get ostracized, etc. So we need to make it possible for workers at Los Alamos and WIPP that have concerns about what they're being asked or told to do to have safe mechanisms to raise those issues, so we don't get out ahead of ourselves. Everybody, the public is at risk, the workers are at risk. We need to take that all into consideration. I think Secretary Flynn wants to do that, and I think we all should try to hold him accountable to seeing that that's what actually happens.
Don, this was exactly what I hoped it would be. It was incredibly informative. My knowledge has expanded. My understanding, I think, is a little better, and it's only a little better because of my lacking, not because of yours. And thank you so very, very much for being here with us.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Yes, unfortunately, this is a continuing situation that's going to be going on not for days and not for months, but for years. So I appreciate your paying attention to it. I appreciate people in the public paying attention to it. The bad news is they're going to have to continue to pay attention to it because, as I say, it is a bad situation, but it could actually get worse.